Methodist Church. My name is Paul Reed. There we are. And I am one of the pastors here at Central. It is good to see everyone here in excuse me, in worship here personally, and it is good to see, as best as I can, the people that are on YouTube or online. It is really good to be here with you all. Central United Methodist Church is an open and affirming church. God loves all people, and we try to emulate that love as best as we can here in the church. And so all people are welcome. The doors are always open. And it is good to see you, so thank you for joining me. Maggie is the co-pilot for the day, so she's going to take over controls.
Good morning, everyone. As Pastor Paul said, I'm Pastor Maggie. I'm the student pastor here at Central. It's very nice to see everyone this morning. We've got a couple of different things going on. Ron Platt is going to be reading our scripture today. You've already heard some of Sean Stafford and his musical talent. You'll get some more of that as the day goes on. We also have our tech team in the back making all of this possible for you all to hear me in the room and for those of you joining online to be able to hear as well. And we are very grateful for those expertise. There are also usher volunteers in the back. If you're new here at Central and you need help finding a bathroom or you need to find some water, they can help direct you. Or if you're just looking for a bulletin or other resources, they can direct you as well. I'm going to be monitoring the chat today as well. So if you see me on my phone, that's usually because I'm engaging in the conversation there and, you know, trying to get some people participating a little more. And we invite those of you who are participating online or those of you who are here in the sanctuary to add your thoughts into the chat, just to, you know, be engaged in conversation there. And then when we come to a later point in our service, when we do our prayer requests, that is also how you can share prayer requests or where you've seen God at work in your world this week. For those of you who are in the sanctuary, if you can please find the burgundy pads that are along the inner part of the aisle and write in your name and some contact information and then pass it down the aisle. This is how we're doing contact tracing. Whether someone develops COVID or RSV or something else later this week, this is how we will notify people who are nearby so that they can be keeping an eye out for any symptoms and hopefully contain the spread of that. I believe those are the majority of our announcements. We're going to be doing some more at the end of the service, but for now, we are gathered together in many times and spaces and places, but we are all gathered together to worship the Lord and to thank our Creator even for days that are cloudy and overcast, because personally, I'm very happy it's not 100 degrees inside the sanctuary, so there's always something to be thankful for. We start our worship together this morning in prayer. You can join along with the words on the screen. Let us pray. Holy and loving Creator, our hearts are troubled. Our souls ache. Our minds race. There seems to be so much fear and hate and mistrust and anger in our world. But new life continues to unfold in front of us. Gardens are growing. Flowers are bursting open. Celebrations of life and love do happen. We know that your grace and your love supersedes all the negativity in the world. Let us shout it out loud. Let us profess our faith and trust in you. May your spirit overwhelm us and give us courage to say, I believe. Our first song this morning is going to be hymn number 451 in the red hymnal, Be Thou My Vision. Please stand as you're willing or able and join us in song.
Oh, my heart, not me, all else to me. Good morning, and the message today is from 2 Corinthians, verse 4, chapter 13 through chapter 5, verse 1, and it's from the Message Bible. We're not keeping this quiet, not on your life. Just like the psalmist who wrote, "I believed it, so I said it," we say what we believe. And what we believe is that the one who raised up the Master Jesus will just as certainly raise us up with you alive. Every detail works to your advantage and to God's glory. More and more grace, more and more people, more and more praise. So we're not giving up. How could we? Even though on the outside it often looks like things are falling apart on us, on the inside, where God is making new life, not a day goes by without his unfolding grace. These hard times are small potatoes compared to the coming good times, the lavish celebration prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today, gone tomorrow. But the things we can't see now will last forever. For instance, we know that when these bodies of ours are taken down like tents and folded away, they will be replaced by resurrection bodies in heaven. God-made, not handmade. And we'll never have to relocate our tents again.
Thanks, Ron. Would you pray with me, please? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and minds and our actions and responses be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. How is it with your soul?
Good.
Good. How has your connection been with God? I decided I'm going to be honest today. I'm tired. I'm beat up. I feel beat up. I get anxious. My anxiety is through the roof. As a clergy person, we say, change is good. You're going to love it. It's good for you all. I'm not a big fan of change. So I have been disconnected with God for a while, and it has been hard for me to reunite with the Creator. But the garden is in, the rain that we had was great, the flowers around our house are bursting open, the kids and the grandkids are coming next weekend, Pride Palooza was a success yesterday, and we had the ability to share God's love for all people. I know life is good. I know God is good. I can preach on and on about how good our God is and about how great our God is, but still, I'm whooped. The letter that we get from Paul today can be broken down into lots of different things. There's a whole bunch of things that I could have unpacked, but I'm going to focus on one section primarily. I just want to talk a little bit about the 2 Corinthians letter. It is very likely that Paul and Timothy wrote it to the church in Corinth, which is modern-day Greece. Some of Paul's letters, there's some arguments about the authenticity of him being the authorship. We can pretend for this one that Paul is truly the author because most people think that he was. It was written around 55 AD, so it predates all of the Gospels. Most of Paul's epistles, all of Paul's epistles predate the Gospels. Gospels were written 70 and 80, 90 AD-ish era. And so this letter was written to a church that Paul established, and it was probably written in two parts. The first part is very loving and very caring, and then the second part seems to be more argumentative. So keep those things in mind when we hear these words today. there was some dissension in the church in Corinth, and Paul was starting to defend himself against the church, or to the church. The church had become disillusioned with Paul and the teachings of Paul. And they started to move away from Paul and look at other apostles. And Paul feared that they were being led astray, that they were starting to go in a direction that a good Christian wouldn't want to go, moving into non-Christ-like opportunities or unknown opportunities. I don't know about you all, but that is sometimes like me. It is easy to get led astray. It is easy to hear those other prophets that are out there saying, hey, come this way. Life is good over here. Life is hard. And if an opportunity comes to make it easy, sometimes we take that opportunity. And that's what the church in Corinth was starting to do, starting to move away from that. Maybe even moving away from God, maybe sometimes like me, moving away from God, not seeing God anyway. Keep all of this in mind as we talk a little bit. The very beginning of the passage, we get the words from Paul, I believed it, so I said it. How often do we do that? We all believe that Jesus is the Christ and the resurrected Son of God, right? Do we say that? Yes or no? I'm getting no's. I think the answer is no. But Paul is out there saying, if you believe it, say it. It is part of our faith to speak out in goodness. It is part of our faith to speak out in what God has done. Paul believed in the resurrection of Jesus. We believe in the resurrection of Jesus. And we, Paul, believe that that resurrection was also available to us. And we, I think, also believe that. And not just today or in the end times, but in all times. That new life is available through Christ. Our faith and our trust is grounded in that. Our faith and trust are grounded in the resurrection that God promises. And that is the source of strength that we should capitalize on or focus on. That new life is available for us in the future, but also in the present. We have that opportunity for new life and new growth today. The promise from God is that newness will come out of death and destruction. The promise from God is that death has no hold on us, whether that death is our physical death in the future or the sometimes angst and the death that we get inside. I chose the trillium flower this morning as my bulletin cover. It was a picture that I took on a hike, I don't know, probably 5-6 weeks ago or something. The trillium is one of the first springtime flowers that sprouts up in the woods. I love the white ones because when I see that, they remind me of the Trinity, the three petals, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit, the three leaves, same thing, that idea of creation and newness and all being together. Trilliums are extremely rare in New York State, but if you find them, you're liable to find like thousands of them. And the hillside that I was on, this was in the Dryden area, walking through the woods. It was a rainy, miserable day, trudging through the woods. And I looked, the leeks were all over the place. I harvested several handfuls of leeks. That's an aside. But then I stopped and I looked up, and this hillside had literally thousands of white trilliums. God creates newness out of nothing. God creates newness and freshness in the springtime. That same God that was active in Jesus the Christ and through Jesus the Christ is active through us now. The same God that raised up Jesus will raise us up. That's what Paul said. These are powerful words for us to hear. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead is able to raise us. And he said, I believe it, so I'm telling you. And I think Paul challenges us to do the same thing. We can all sit here on a Sunday morning and say, oh, I believe in God. That we go through the Nicene Creeds and all of those things. We can say the Lord's Prayer. We can do all of those things. But get out of here and say it. I think that's the challenge from Paul, is to go out into the world, wherever the world is. And when we see that life is tough, say God is good. Life is hard. And I've said many times, nowhere in the Bible does it say life is easy. I'm not a Bible expert, certainly, but I've read most of it a couple times. Nowhere does it say life is easy. If you find that passage, please let me know. Faith does not make us immune to the suffering and the bad. The belief in the resurrection, the belief in God, the belief in all of those things that we have does not make us immune to the tough life that's ahead of us. But our faith does allow us to not give up. And that's what Paul tells us in verse 16. Don't give up. Other translations say, don't lose heart. I used to say to my kids at school, and I would sometimes say to my own kids, and I probably said it to some of you, suck it up, buttercup. I don't know if God would use those words, but I think I hear God saying that sometimes. Suck it up, buttercup. Life's not easy, but I am with you. Accepting defeat seems like the only option at times, but Maya Angelou said, when we encounter many defeats, do not be defeated. Life hands you curves all the time. You don't have to accept those defeats. Don't get defeated. I know many of us in here are struggling through something. Don't get defeated. Paul says that even though on the outside it looks like things are falling apart, God is making new life inside of us. Although the world may seem like it's going to heck in a handbasket quickly, although your life may seem like it's going to heck in a handbasket quickly, God is making new things inside us. Sometimes it may be tough to see that. Don't focus on the here and now. Those are fleeting experiences. Those are going to be gone. Yesterday is yesterday because it's not here anymore. Forget about that. God's daily grace overflows in us all the time, if we accept it, and if we say yes, and if we say, I believe it. Even in the midst of chaos and heartache and pain, God is there saying, here, rest. God says to us, I got it. God may say, suck it up, buttercup, but then God also says, I got this. The Holy Spirit is active and bringing new things to us all the time. Do you believe that? The Holy Spirit is active in us, bringing newness all the time. Do you believe that? Do you say that to people? Suffering itself is not redemptive. It's a part of life. God doesn't give us the pain and the suffering, but God makes something out of that. For me, those suffering things that we all go through that Paul talks about, the suck it up part, I see God more clearly. And I'm able to build a deeper and better relationship with God as a result of that. My dad died about 16 or 17 years ago. I was devastated. The thoughts through my head were like, why would a loving God let my dad die? Because now there's two grandkids that don't have a grandfather. Those were the things that stuck in my head, and I was mad. I was really mad at God, and there were many times that we had shouting matches at each other. I don't know if God listened or not. I certainly did not listen to God. But out of that whole stretch of time, and it took me about a year or so to finally reconnect with God, my faith was deeper because of that. Libba Bray, who is a New York Times bestseller author, said there's an ancient traditional tribal proverb that says, before we can see properly, we must first shed our tears to clear the way. You got to get rid of all the dirt and the smudge that's in your life, the pollen that's hanging out. You got to get rid of all of that stuff before you can see the goodness that's out there. You got to work through the bad stuff to be able to see the goodness that's out of there. And it is God's grace that helps us work through that, that brings us through the difficulties in the world. Do you believe that? Do you proclaim that? Do you go out and boldly say, my God is great? Paul closes the passage by saying, for instance, we know these bodies of ours are like tents and get folded away. and then replaced by resurrection bodies. I was thinking about this last night as we were cleaning up from Pride Palooza. Zoop, tent goes together, plunk in the bag. And then underneath the ground where we were standing was new ground. God took that tent that we had and packed it away, and God will take the tent that we have and will pack it away and create something good out of that. Knowing and understanding God's grace gives us the courage to move on. Knowing that God is lavishly pouring out goodness to us on a daily basis makes us go through life. It frees us to look at the earthly spaces that we have and think of the ultimate goodness that there is out there. The physical spaces that we identify with, our bodies, our homes, our cities, our churches, whatever, are ultimately going to be taken down and or destroyed. God will make something out of that. The social principles that define who we are, our inter and intrapersonal networks, societal networks, our cultures, we are not in control. God is creating something good out of all of this. God is out there guiding each one of us into a new and better life. Like the Trillium coming up in the springtime, there's newness in us that is coming up. And amid the insecurity of our flimsy tents that we have a building presented by God, not made by human hands. What the Spirit creates cannot be destroyed. What God makes cannot be broken apart, but is overflowing and freely given justice and mercy, making the lives that we currently have roomy and expansive domains of goodness and grace. Do you believe that? Do you say that? Do you go out of this building and say, I believe? I am who I am because of the goodness of God. Do you believe that? Do you say that? This promise in this chapter that we have, God offers us immense hope. God gives us the ability to know that no matter what happens in life, and some of us are facing almost insurmountable things, no matter what happens, God is right there. And you have a secure and glorious future with our Creator. Grasp on to those truths. Grasp on to that reality that God is with us. Siblings, the struggles are real, but so is God. Do you believe that? Do you proclaim that? Amen.
We're going to sing again. The hymn is number 2216 in the Faith We Sing, which is the black hymnal in the pews. This is called When We Are Called to Sing Your Praise. Please stand as you're willing or able.
Sing your praise with hearts of fear.
invite you to offer your prayer requests on the live stream chat, or you can share where you've seen God at work in your life this week. As we listen to the music, that'll give you some time to put things in. And for those in the sanctuary, during this music, we can reflect and think about where we have seen God at work in our world this week, and maybe some places where faith has given us hope to keep going. Thank you. In our bulletin, you can see the names of people that we are praying for, in particular this week here at Central. This week in the hospital or recovering at home, we remember especially Karen Friga, Norma Livingston, Renee Serson, and Carolyn and Pat Stanford. In our prayer program, which is how we pray for the entire membership of the church over the course of the year, this week we pray for Deb and Rand Barnum, Pat and Carol Chandler, Patty and John Denman, Debbie Fisher and Bill Guilford, Sheila Hughes, Norma Livingston, Deborah O'Neill, Helen and Steve Schatz, and George Watkins. And family and friends with special needs for prayer this week include Richard Frederick, Frank Stephen Childs, John Carmine, Moy Zalea, Eric Houseman, Stephen John Schultz, Rhonda Hartley, Bernie Wilcox, Ray Frederick, and Maggie Hungerford. If you know any of those names, if you know any of those folks, give them a call, send them a card, let them know that their Central family is thinking of them and loves them. And on the live stream, we have prayers for peace of mind, for healing, and for God's blessings.
Thanks. Thank you. And as we do every week, the challenge is, where have you seen God? But also, we're extending that to, where would you like to see God? Ooh. Like, what in your life, where would you like to see God be active? And I have one big joy to share. Yesterday, we had Pride Palooza at Otsonango Park. We had a tent display like we always do, and it was very well attended by the public. There were lots of people there. I don't know, there's several of us went. I don't even know how many people were there, but there were a boatload of people. and it was really good to share God's love to all people. I have a purple t-shirt that says, "This pastor loves you" on it, and it's got a multicolored display flag. I'm not sure the right words to say on it. And there were several people that came up and just said thank you for being the church that loves all people. And I just had some great conversations with people just saying that this is who we are. And, you know, God loves all people. And I say sometimes God doesn't care. God does. God doesn't care who you are because God doesn't care. God loves all people. So that's but it was really good. So those of you that were there, if you have anything to say about it, that would be... Sarah, you want to talk a little bit? It should be on there.
About 20 minutes before Pride Palooza ended, we had a young person come up to the tent and kind of ask, well, what do I do?
Oh,
we
yeah.
kind of explained that, oh, we're a church. This is who we are,
That's
all
right.
this other stuff. Pastor Paul and I talked with him. And then they said, I just moved up from Texas. I have no idea what to do here. The fact that we live in a community where people can be safe, the fact that there were at least two other churches there with us, and there was places that this person could see they could be safe, whether in churches, whether in community organizations. And it makes me very thankful that I've grown up in a church where we've done this and that this is not anything out of the ordinary for me. And at the same time, I'm very grateful that we were able to show that, yes, there is a safe place out there.
Yeah, I remember that. He was just like, his head was like, we don't have that in Texas. Nope. Any other joy? Yeah, Keith. You got to do it.
So for those of you who do not know what Pride Palooza is, the Gay Pride Coalition of Binghamton every year has this celebration during Gay Pride to just celebrate the ability to be ourselves. And for those of you who don't know what that's like, I grew up, well, much of my life in a church that really didn't accept me. When they found out about me, I was no longer a part of the church. So to be here and to be accepted and be loved by this awesome family of people is a wonderful thing. So to be at Pride yesterday with a bunch of my friends and family from this church and other churches as well, it's so awesome to see and share that openness with people who are often afraid of or resent the church and what they've been told about God that's not necessarily correct. It's just a wonderful thing to be part of that family. And again, and I thank you, all of you who participate, and welcome the gay world into this church and the people who, like myself, who have been shunned previously. Yet we still love God, and it's nice to be able to be with people who are of that same mindset. Thank you. And also another thing I've been wanting to say for years, I'm grateful for the gardens that you mentioned and the flowers and the fragrances of spring. I mean, like the lily of the valley, the lilacs, the wisteria. It's just like spring is my favorite time in the garden, definitely.
You all probably didn't know, but we have a bubble blowing expert in the congregation. I had 2-gallon jugs of bubbles for the kids, and one of the adults that was there went through almost the entire gallon. Keith, do you know who that person might be? I have no clue. Yeah. It was just great, because somebody would be out there doing bubbles, and all these little kids would be like over there with. It was just great to see that.
Good morning. We have a big couple of weeks coming up in my household, and I am asking for God to show up and for you all to pray for me, for God to show up so that I can keep my cool, right? There's a lot of stuff, and it's not bad, but it's a lot. It's just a lot. And I don't want to lose it and then react in ways that are unkind or unloving, especially to the people whom I love the most, who are most likely to get the brunt of it. So that's what I'm looking for, is for people and God to show up in the next week or two to help me keep my cool.
Thanks.
Paul.
I do one. So, next week is going to be joyful but hard, with it being Pastor Michelle's last week. And so I probably won't bring this up next week. But next Monday, the 17th, is going to be a big, crazy day for us, because Tyler is going to be taking a truck to Indiana with all of our stuff. And then that night, I am finally meeting with DCOM to become a certified candidate.
Excellent.
Which I've been trying to do for almost a year. And basically every time they would tell me like, oh yeah, we're meeting. And I would be like, great, I'm in India those days for work. And so we're having a special session so that I can get certified before moving. And it's exciting to finally be coming to that that touch point in this journey of candidacy, and be one step closer to making it through this process, because it's very long. So yeah, excellent. I'm grateful for that, and I'm hoping God shows up too, because they're going to be asking they ask a lot of questions about, what do you believe and why do you believe this, and I'm hoping that I can also stay like cool and collected and like give good, thoughtful answers instead of just like,
blah, 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 blah.
Exactly.
Thanks, Maggie. Mm-hmm. Let's go to God in prayer. Holy Creator, we believe. We know that you are present in our life at all times. But God, sometimes things get rough. Sometimes we struggle. Sometimes we hurt, we ache. Life throws us curves. Unplanned things happen. God, it is then when we need to know you are with us. Shed your grace on us and shower us with your love. Give us rest. And remind us that everything will be okay. That you will create newness out of the chaos that we are in. That peace will come. That love will triumph. That justice will happen. God, it is hard, but we know that your presence is always guaranteed. Creator God, we have listed names in our families our friends, our siblings that are ailing in body, mind, spirit, or relationship. We have brought up joys this morning. We've brought up our concerns. You know our thoughts. Help us to see the goodness and the newness that is present in everything. God, we turn to you now and offer up names out loud of people that are in our lives that can use your presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Creator God, we ask all of this through your Son's prayer that Jesus taught each one of us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We respond to God's gifts in our lives by offering ourselves and our resources to God's purpose. Everything we give is a response of gratitude to God. There are many ways to respond to God's work in our lives, be that giving of musical talents, of time here with Shepherd's Supper or the Clothing Center, and also our financial resources. Please consider how you will continue your offerings and pledges to the work of the church. In the sanctuary, you can give in the two boxes that are there in the back. You can also give online on our website. You can mail a check to the church office, however you want to do it. And you can also do that through direct deposit as well. Those gifts immediately come back into the church. I haven't seen Canood this morning, but I know that we've been in the upper 200s.
We did 300.
I was wondering if we cracked three.
Who's, Linda, how? Right. He sent an email this week that we, 312, someone said? 312 on Thursday at Shepherd's Supper.
It was our first time that wasn't like a special event that was over 300.
Right.
And, you know, one thing that I will also just mention from the Pride Palooza event yesterday was one person who came up to us and was like, oh, I know you. When I first came to Binghamton, I was unhoused, and this is right. Where I came to get food. This is where I still direct people to, and I was like, I'm so glad. And so there is a need in this community for the things that Central does, and there is a need in the world for the things that we contribute to through UMCOR and, you know, other things through United Methodist Church. So let us pray a prayer of blessing over these offerings. Lord, you know each of us, you know each of our needs, and that is true for all of your creation. Bless these gifts, help them to multiply and to go out into this world and to carry your love wherever they go. May every life that they touch feel your love, feel your grace, and feel the love and grace that we offer here at Central as well. Amen. If you're on the live stream, and even if you're not, please do comment, share. You know, we are trying to get the word out about Central. And so just sort of putting stuff out onto your various Facebooks or sending something to your friends is always helpful. There are a number of different announcements here in the bulletin, just a couple to highlight really quickly. Monday night book discussion is still on next week. We've got June's mini mission project, which is supporting Church World Services Be the Change, BEE. And so if you want to know more about that, Pastor Paul can tell you about it. There's also information in the Welcome Center. There's a few other things that are going on. I would just encourage you to check out what's going on in the bulletin. And I know there's one special announcement about some stuff in the Welcome Center.
Yeah, so Bonnie, can you come up to... Bonnie's going to use the scripture mic. Jason, if we can have that hot for her.
Good morning. As we prepare to say our goodbyes to Pastor Michelle next week, don't forget, after the church service, we have our farewell reception, so I hope that most of you will be able to come and join us. But I know that many of us are taking time to reflect on the different relationships that we've developed with Michelle over the last 10 years as our pastor, as our mentor, as our coworker, a team leader, and most importantly, as our friend. So we wanted to give you the opportunity to take some time to put in writing maybe some favorite memories or just well wishes for she and Nate and Alice, or maybe even a funny story that you want to share. And so in the Welcome Center, we have a pile of blank cards. You are welcome to take a few moments this morning after church to write something down, or take one or two cards with you and bring them back next Sunday. And we will have some place that you can put them, and she can, you know, be sent off with all of our thoughts and wishes and memories and prayers for best wishes for all of them in their new church home. Thank you.
All right. So we're going to end our time together this morning with one more hymn. It's number 572, Back in the Red Hymnal. This is Pass It On. Again, stand as you're willing or able as we all sing together.
Christ, go into the world. Do not stay quiet. Do not give up. Remember and know the newness that is created by God, the author of life, through Christ the Son, with the essence of the Holy Spirit in each one of us this day and all days. Amen.